pretty much what we did at our clinic this year for the American. Talk about a lot of video I put together on new rule stuff. And any questions, feel free to interrupt. Really, seriously, I know you get in these things and nobody likes to ask questions, interrupt, but it really is a good thing because you don't want to leave with any questions about anything. So, and I'll try and give you a little background on some of this as we go through it. So the sliding ball carrier, targeting the sliding ball carrier. Had some issues over the last few years with when a quarterback slides. By rule, he wasn't defenseless. He wasn't protected in any way, shape, or form till he was on the ground. So that left a lot of openings for defensive players to really nail him. Moreover, our quarterbacks, they weren't very good at sliding. They were putting themselves in jeopardy in a lot of cases. So we tried to put some teeth into the rule on targeting. So, and the first and foremost thing is he's sliding feet first. He's not sliding feet first, he's not protected until he gets on the ground. But we went further than what the original rulemakers talked about because we wanted to give him maximum protection. So what we did, we told our offensive coaches that if you want to almost guarantee your quarterback can get up and work, play the next play, tell him to slide early. Don't try to get the first down. Don't try to get an extra yard. Because if you do, if you slide after contact's imminent, you're not going to be protected other than the really serious targeting fouls. So if you slide early, you slide feet first, you slide before contact's imminent, you shouldn't even get hit. And that's what our defensive coaches told us. When I went to our meetings, they asked, well, where are we going to put the football? Well, where we put the football, where by rule it says it's dead, when the first body part other than a hand and foot touches. So the coaches said, why are you doing that? And I said, I don't know. So they said, if you give him the ball, if you declare the ball dead and give it to him where he starts his slide, we won't hit him. We won't have any reason to hit him, assuming he does it early enough. So that was about a week before the coordinator's meeting. We went into the coordinator's meeting, and it was unanimous that we decided that we're going to make the ball dead, and I know there was some discussion about that particular verbiage. We're going to make the ball dead. It was our intent to make the ball dead as soon as he gives himself up. As soon as he clearly starts his slide, the ball's dead. The play is over. So anything that happens after that is a dead ball action, a dead ball foul, assuming he gets hit. So fourth down, he has a clear feet first slide. Somebody hits him late, doesn't make the first down. Ball goes to team B after a 15-yard penalty. So these are the guys. Slides early prior to imminent contact. He's a defenseless player. Whether he slides early or not is not relevant to the defenseless player. This onus is still on the defense to avoid punishing hits or forcible hits to the head and neck area. But we're going to give the defense a little more leeway if he's sliding late. And again, the ball's dead. So we'll look at some plays. And this one was a huge uproar all over the planet. This was not a foul last year, and it is not a foul this year. He's not sliding feet first. The knees are in advance of the feet. This is not a feet first slide. So he is not protected until he's on the ground. The defender initiates contact with his shoulder, goes shoulder to shoulder, and may slide up into the head. Just because initial contact to the shoulder doesn't take off contact to the head, but the primary force is with the shoulder to shoulder. He's not protected. Had he slid early, had he slid feet first, this would have been a late hit, and potentially even targeting, depending on what replays ended up showing. There is some contact to the head, would support targeting if it was a feet first slide. But that is not a feet first slide, and he also slid late. This is a feet first slide. Ball's going to go right there, which I'd say looks like I think that's the 27, maybe the 32, something like that. So he is sliding feet first before contact's imminent. The onus is on the defender. This was targeting last year because he comes in with the crown, and that's what was ruled. So this was a foul last year. It's forcible to the head and neck area. But since he wasn't defenseless last year, that would not have been a foul for that. But he is leading with the crown. He lowers his head right there. We will consider that the crown. So that would have been a foul last year. So this is probably the best example I have.
Can replay help with the spot of that ball?
Yeah. Yes, if we miss it, if there's indisputable evidence that we miss that, replay can fix it. It's in relative to a first down. We talked a lot about that. When we decided to put the ball there, I talked to a lot of line of scrimmage officials, and they said, no, it really wouldn't be a big deal for them. Looking at it in replay, we're only going to fix it if it's an indisputable miss. So in most cases, I don't think you'll ever see replay change it, but certainly it is possible. And here, you can see he gets about another yard after he starts that obvious slide. So that's what we have. This is what we want to avoid. And if my defensive coaches are true to their word, they're not going to hit him when this happens at all, much less a shot to the head and neck area. And for everybody's purposes, when you see a player do this, I'm not a concussion expert, but I've seen a lot of sessions with that. When you see a player go on the ground and he puts his hands up like that, that's an indicator that there is a potential concussion situation. You're just going to stop the game. Well, you're not going to stop it while play's going on, but you're going to get somebody out right away, whether he gets up or not, when he goes into that position.
This would be a dead ball foul.
This would have been a dead ball foul. Last year, this was a live ball foul. This year, it would be a dead ball foul.
Let me also, you said any action after that would be a dead ball. So in this case, the fumble would not be?
That's correct. There's no fumble here.
Okay.
That is absolutely correct. Ball is dead. One more time. Well, probably about right there. Ball's dead about right there. There can be no fumble on the play. Which is another great reason for our offensive coaches to teach their quarterbacks. Not only you're not going to get your quarterback hit, you're not going to lose the football either. So a lot of good reasons, a lot of great safety reasons for this rule and the way we implemented it.
And you said earlier, if it's fourth down, we're giving that ball to B.
Yes. Yes. If he's short right here of the first down, then it's over. B gets the ball, and then everything after that. You penalize after on B's possession.
You consider this player having committed to this slide early enough?
This is on the edge. I think so. I mean, he's committed here, and the defense really hasn't started to go down yet. I mean, it's close. It is close. This is certainly going to be targeting no matter what. Whether if this wasn't to the head and neck area, whether we'd have a body, a personal foul. For a late hit, it would be close. Probably not in real time would be my guess. But we'd certainly support it. Obviously lots of shots in that one. And this is just the coach's copy of it. Could you get a little more perspective officials? Referees, I'd really, in this case, once he starts coming off this way, I'd really rather come up this way and get this look through here, because as you try and come in behind him, you're looking at a lot of bodies there. Really, I think the call, in fact, I'm sure it came from down here. Great call by the head linesman on this play. Had a great look right into it. It did come from here. We'll go to the next one. This one is a feet first slide. Whether it's a foul or not, coaches tend to think it was. This is close. Does he go shoulder to shoulder? Does he go helmet to helmet? Not really sure. It's certainly a late slide. So you're not going to get a personal foul on this, a late hit, but it could certainly be targeting. I believe replay let it stand. It's close. But that's the look. We'd really like him to slide earlier on this. But certainly the onus is on the defense to avoid the contact to the head and neck area. All right, questions on sliding quarterback. Blocking below the waist.
Sorry, I have a question.
Yes?
Is it safe to say once that kick breaks, that's when you're going to say that quarterback is sliding?
you've got to see the feet come out first. That's the number one thing. You have to see the feet first. Because if we go back to the first play, we go back to this one, he's going down. But you have to see, you see, the hip started to go down, but he's not going feet first. So you can't, you've got to wait to see how he slides before you can declare. Now, if he does bring his feet out here, you're certainly going to come back to, I would think, where his butt starts to drop. Don't get in a hurry just because he's going down. That make sense?
Yes.
Anything else? Blocking below the waist, probably the most confusing rule in the book. I was actually on the phone with a coach from another conference today, trying to go through this. Players restricted. This is the first and most important thing to remember. We all know about restricted and unrestricted players at the snap. The addition is that now at the snap, we don't have the low blocking zone anymore. You don't have 7 yards either side of the ball. It is all strictly based on the tackle box. And a player is restricted if they've been inside the tackle, if they ever go outside the tackle box during the play, or if they start outside. At any point, they become restricted immediately. And we're still using the torso of the tackle with the torso of the back to put him out. I've heard word that other people may be defining it slightly differently, but that really is unchanged in our guidance. Torso to torso, not leg to leg, but torso to torso. And it's the second player from the snapper, the normal tackle position. I know technically the verbiage is still 5 yards, but it's such a rare occurrence that we really don't want you to go into that by putting the tight end in the tackle box. We've told our coaches that the normal tight end position is always going to be restricted. He can't crack the defensive end low back toward the ball, and he's always got a block from the side. So normal tight end position out is always restricted. Certainly an unbalanced line, the tight end would become unrestricted in an unbalanced line on the weak side.
Does an interior lineman become restricted?
He does. Once anybody leaves the tackle box, a back, lineman, quarterback, anybody leaves the tackle box, they're immediately restricted to 10 to 2, and they can't block back toward the ball until the ball carrier has clearly crossed the line of scrimmage. So here we see, and it's close here, whether our left wing, I'd say his torso is breaking the tackle's torso right here. He's certainly in the tackle box. So we're putting both wings in the tackle box snap. 88, who was unrestricted last year, is restricted this year in that position. So right now, 25 has left the tackle box. As soon as he takes that step to the outside, he's left the tackle box and he's restricted himself to blocking 10 to 2, and he can't block back toward the original position of the snap low. And I'll use the terms, and it may be confused. I use the terms blocking back toward the ball. That doesn't mean where the location of the ball, it means the position of the ball at the snap. It's just easier to say it that way. So you see 25 comes and cracks the linebacker. This was legal last year. It's illegal this year. The quarterback is near the line of scrimmage. He has not clearly crossed the line of scrimmage. Go back and see where, I think we snapped it from the one here. So I'd have to put him pretty much in the end zone before that would become a legal block, and then it wouldn't be legal anymore. So that is an illegal block below the waist by the left wing back.
Sorry?
Yes?
That first line was really good. So as soon as anyone that's originally unrestricted leaves the tackle box, they become restricted.
That's correct.
So if we have a guard on the sweep, and then immediately comes back toward the ball, blocks 12, but 10 and 2, it's illegal now, right? It becomes illegal. Is that right?
If he's blocking back toward the snap.
Because he's now become unrestricted.
Once he leaves the tackle box, that's correct. Or if he goes downfield. If he clearly goes downfield. And we're not talking about close line play on the block low back toward the ball. Let's say number 57 here, he cracks down low at the goal line on nose. That would not be illegal. We're talking once he gets into the second level. That's when he becomes restricted. Not really initial line play, even though he technically may have stepped beyond the line of scrimmage. And as you can see, I guess our left tackle blocks low. He kind of slides down. But had that been a low block, it would be legal. He's blocking back toward the ball, but he's still in the tackle box. And here's another one. You watch the lead back on this one. We're going to go this way. He's going to circle around and crack low. A lot of questions. Was this 10-2? We'll go to the end zone last year. I believe this was 10-2. We got a lot of 10-2 plays coming up in a little bit, by the way. Courtesy of one of our schools. Not Navy. See, he hits him in the front of the knee. He hits him in the thigh in the front. So that kind of has to be 10-2. Even though his body is facing this way, you know, his hips have turned, and he is in that 10-2 zone right there, in my opinion. But he is blocking back toward the ball. Legal last year, illegal this year. Pretty much can make it much easier to officiate. But what you're going to have to do is if you see this block, whoever has that man is going to have to come find the ball carrier. It's just like calling defensive holding downfield or just about anything else. See the foul, find the ball carrier, determine if it's illegal at the point. So it's got to be a two-step process. And there's some more crackbacks just to make sure everybody's unaware. This one right here, we're looking at the bottom of the screen. This is the normal crackback, has always been illegal, will always be illegal until the ball carrier clearly crosses the line. He did not do that on this play when the contact occurred. At number 3 at the top of the screen. Back. Whose man is that? Back judge. As soon as he turns to the inside, stay with him. Considered a brick in his hand. Let me see. I think it comes in on the end zone here. See, it's almost like this is 10-2. He gets in the 10-2, but he's still blocking. The angle of his block is back this way, so this is a foul. He needs to get more in front and go upfield. The direction of the block needs to go upfield. Here's what they're starting to do. You look at number 3 at the top. This is what they're starting to do, and we don't want to get fooled by this. He just drops down and lets the player go over him. This is not a foul. He just drops straight down, lets the defender fall, He's not really blocking toward anywhere. He's just falling down and letting the player fall over him. So that is not a foul. All right. This came up actually twice last year. And I don't think it's ever been addressed, but I had some discussions with some other coordinators, and everybody pretty much agrees. If you block low on a change of possession, kickoff, whatever, into the tackle, it's still a foul. It's going to end zone. If you go through somebody to make a tackle, if you go through somebody low to make a tackle, it's illegal. I think this happened either the same week or within 2 weeks of each other. I got another play to show you. So that is still a foul. Here's another one. After a missed block, a fake field goal, intercepted. And here's a really good example of why it should be illegal. This is a pretty punishing hit. Makes the tackle anyway, but it's still a foul. In the end zone. Illegal. Just another low block after an interception. Blocking, you can tell blocking below is really a point of emphasis. We just don't want to miss an illegal one at any point. So coming up here, we should probably have it here, and maybe even from here we should have this one. Unusual one here. Watch the kicker. The actual kicker on this play. This one? No, wrong play. It'll be the next play. It'll be the next play. Don't watch the kicker on this one. Watch the kicking team player right here. Here he is. There he goes. There he goes low. So it is a kicker. Go to the next one. Let's go to this one. So this is the kicker. Same team. Illegal. And then we still want to have forcible contact. You know, in real time, this is going to look really bad. We're looking right here. He just barely gets him. Touches him on the leg. You still want forcible contact. We understand why you'd see that. He's not supposed to do that. Makes some contact, really not forcible enough. All right. Right guard. Peel backs. Right guard. This one's really close. I think they called it and picked it up. Probably would have supported it. Is he going back or is he going parallel? It's a safety play, so we'd have supported it if he'd left it down. But remember, once the ball's outside the tackle box, everybody is restricted from blocking back toward their own goal line. Before it's left the tackle box, restricted players are prevented from blocking back toward their own goal line. Right. I don't have the players on this one, but I think we'll be able to see. It's the lead. This is 10-2. I think we got to go to the end zone. Agreed? 10-2. Defender can clearly protect himself. So he's coming in from the front. Legal block. Also 10-2. Looking right here. In front. Blocking really away from the snap. 10-2. Legal block. Into two. End zone on this one. He's actually blocking. I'd consider this north-south. He's blocking upfield, and he's definitely in the front. Pink uniforms. More 10-2, go to the end zone. See, he's blocking in front, but you see the kind of a cross, so he ends up on the side, but he started his block. He's right in front of him. So this is a 10-2. And this is a crossover step. So he's in front, and he crosses over and puts himself in to the side, so this is also legal.
Legal?
Both legal. And again, had this player started running this way before he committed, then it'd be from the side. But you can see he turns his body as soon as the player starts to go down, makes that little crossover step, and puts his side, makes it a side appear to be a side block, but not a foul. I'm going to show one more of these. Legal block here, obviously. And I'll show you one that's illegal, and then we'll move on. looking at this guy right here. It's close, but it looks like he lunges at the last second back toward the ball. So that would become a foul in zone. It's close. Probably in real time it'd be tough to pick up. Tough one. That's, and then we have.
That guy was kind of pushed.
Well, let's look at that.
Maybe he wasn't here, but he could.
Yeah, I can see that. It looks like he kind of tries to chip one guy and then goes low on the other.
Yeah.
Probably in real time you wouldn't throw this. I'd be okay with that. Left wing back, oh, already showed that one. Why that's on this one, contact appears high. All right, so let's, anything on block and blow the waist. Remember, once the ball leaves, everybody's restricted, just like always. Ineligible downfield. This obviously has gotten a lot of national attention over the last couple years. We've desperately tried to get it moved back to 1 yard and have been stymied every time we turn around, because it's totally unfair. So what the committee told us to do was to tighten it up, so we tightened it up. Our guideline in the past was the entire body had to be more than 3 yards. Now it's any part of the player's body beyond 3 when the pass is released. And as I'm sure you've heard, the backside line of scrimmage official has primary now, not the umpire. Umpire's still secondary. So we're here, we're looking, I believe it's our right guard here. Let me move this over here so I can see. Nope, the center on this one. Initial block's legal. Once he goes beyond, he can't come back. So up here. Here we hope we'd see it up here. Maybe the umpire would have a good shot at this one, since it's so delayed. Once he throws the football now, that would become illegal. Even though once he throws it, he's not beyond anymore. Once he's beyond, it's too late.
So which wing is primary?
It would be the backside here, because the flow of the play really has started. Initially, it was going that way, but now it's coming back this way. So right here. Hopefully we'd be able to get a shot at this. But like I said, on this particular play, the umpire may have a shot because he really doesn't have a lot else going on, which is very unusual. Right guard. We're looking at the right guard right here. Here, the offside official, or they're actually both offsides on this one. We get it from up here. Ball snapped at the 26, and you can see at the time of the pass, he's about the 30. So last year his whole body was, or it was close. Certainly now it's illegal. We'll talk a little bit about offensive pass interference as we go through this as well, because we've had a little more of a, at least in our conference, we're putting a little more emphasis on the lineman coming out and blocking at the second level on the linebacker. So here we're snapping it from the 11. This is close. This is close, but we'd support it. And what we told our coaches, and it's not really all the coaches. There's a handful of coaches that really have taken huge advantage. They know we never call it. They know when we call it, we're usually long, so we even call it less than ever before. So it's never being called. And if it is, they'll take their chances. We told the coaches, if you don't want to take a chance on getting a somewhat technical call on this, don't send him down that far. I had one coach say, well, we teach our guys to stop at 2 yards. I said, that's great. I wish everybody did that and we wouldn't have this problem. But once he's advancing downfield, you're subject to an ineligible downfield. We are being more technical. You still want him to be more than 3 yards when the pass is released. but it's not the whole body, because you know when it's the whole body, he's really at four or five by the time the pass is caught, maybe six or seven, and it's a huge advantage. Center. He gets lost, but you see, he's also advancing downfield. I mean, he's kind of lost, but he's still going that way. They want us to be technical. Ball, where was the ball snapped? At the 20, 25? Supposed to stay there. Foul, coming from down here, hopefully. Don't want OPI in this one. This is a foul for ineligible downfield. Even though he's going to get the linebacker and he blocks, pass is being thrown down here at the bottom. So for timing purposes, we wouldn't want offensive pass interference. If we're throwing the ball in this area right here, if we throw it in this area right here, then we'd want this to be offensive pass interference. This we would just want to be an ineligible downfield. Left guard. Even that far behind, even though it seems like it doesn't mean anything, I'm actually a little surprised. Coaches say it's easily coachable. Don't send your guy down that far downfield if you don't want, a foul.
Well, it's a question for me.
I doubt
it's dumb. But is the point behind a legal man downfield to make sure that the deep guys are not giving guys that aren't eligible cover, right? Isn't that the point, or no?
Well, the point is you don't want those big guys out in a place where they can block once you pass it.
Okay.
That's one point. The other point is the rule. The defense has to be able to read the play. If they see linemen firing out and they get more than 3 yards, they should be able to read screen or run at that point. Same thing with blocking downfield. You know, once somebody's blocking downfield, the defense legitimately should be able to read screen or run. Mm-hmm. Good help from the head linesman on this play. Top of the screen. We're looking at right guard? Now he comes up, the linebacker comes up, so we don't want offensive pass interference on that particular play, but we do want ineligible downfield. Here's a good example. This we do want, we're looking at the right guard, we do want offensive pass interference on this play. He goes out, he blocks the linebacker, and there's a measure of time. This is what I was talking about earlier. There's a measure of time between when the block occurs right now and the quarterback throws a football. In fact, there's a lot of time. So like I said, once he does that, the defense should legitimately be able to play run or screen. And because he just simply cannot do that. So this should have been offensive pass. Ineligible downfield and offensive pass interference, but in this case, you'd really only report and announce one of them on the play. I think we called IDP, but we would want OPI as well. Any questions on IDP? Because I've got way more plays than I want to do. Any questions on that? Offensive pass interference. I think we struggled with this in our conference with OPI, and I think we struggle nationally. I mean, I watch games on TV, and if we call it, we're almost always wrong. We get about half of them right, and if we don't call it, we're wrong an awful lot. So we're gonna look at a lot of plays for offensive pass interference. I wish we'd get the rule changed to be only a 10-yard foul to make it a little bit easier, but they haven't done that. So three categories: extend and clearly separate. And I actually added the word clearly because I want clear separation. Blocking downfield and picks. really good plays in here. So here, this is the extend and separate category. Watch the wide receiver at the top. You can even see it from the line feed that he goes into him, and then all of a sudden he's this far away. So something must have happened. Here's what happened. Two hand separates himself. We've got a couple more looks, maybe. Clear separation. Pushes off. Opens himself up. Top of the screen. Watch the body language of the defender right there. The upper body, they're driving forward, they're running forward, and all of a sudden his upper body goes backwards, and then you get that separation. That's a foul. It doesn't take a lot of separation, but it was enough in that case. The other player hadn't come in to make the play. Certainly would have been an easy catch. Wide receiver at the top. You really want this one called. Again, it's that body language at the top of the screen. Again, it's not, you can tell it, that's all the separation he got. Well, guess what? That's all he needed on this particular play. This is offensive pass interference. I think the ball's up long enough that maybe the back judge, where's the back judge's man? Let's see. He's got tight end here. See if he can get over there in time. Ball goes up. I think he can. His guy's going across the route. Sees the ball go up. So certainly the line of screen, the deep wing should have seen it. Potentially here, and then the back judge should have seen this. Definitely, absolutely offensive pass interference. And here's one that's not enough for a foul. Actually, this is enough for a foul. Excuse me. No RPS. No RPS. This is a foul. I have two fouls on this play, but it's not RPS, but it is. It's clearly offensive pass interference. And the linesman gets it, which is a really terrific call. Back judge's man. Kind of look. Here's his guy, so he's kind of looking through it, kind of jumped out at him. So really good pickup. Now we're in the no fouls. No separation here. Still, you know, has to be separation. You're looking right here over the middle. See, there's just nothing, no reaction at all from the defender for any separation. He didn't get any at all. Same thing. And you may have seen this play on the national video. I respectfully disagree that there's anything here. We're looking at this player right here. The linebacker and the tight end just come together, and then he cuts off the contact. I just don't see any extension. I don't see any separation. I don't want this as a foul. It's a good look at it here. TV stopping it. See, he doesn't really separate himself. He just cuts off the contact. You agree, John?
He ran away from
him. Yeah. I just don't see him do anything. He doesn't extend his arm. He doesn't block him. He doesn't displace the defender. Just don't see anything there. This happened to show up on another video I did. This is, by the way, this is, some of you may know him. That's unsportsmanlike conduct. Has no business being on the field. He certainly has no business being on the field. I won't use the words he's saying. But certainly has no business doing that. Should have been unsportsmanlike conduct. Here's the play that he's mad about. blocking downfield, wide receiver at the top. And we'll talk about mechanics on this too. This is a pick. This is a pick. It's blocking downfield. It's everything you can imagine. The defender has position. Wants to go with his receiver. Picks him off. Offense need to. He seeks him out. Everything's wrong with this. So the question becomes: Does the pass clearly cross the line of scrimmage? Which means, is the pass really a yard or more beyond the line of scrimmage? And it is, as you can see, it is. Mechanically, the onus is on the line of scrimmage guy to come in and tell the calling official it didn't cross the line. And you'll see what happens here. It makes us look indecisive. Well, I don't have that part, I guess. It kind of makes us look indecisive on that when we have the deep wing going right to the line of scrimmage official to see if it crossed the line or not. Whereas really we just want the deep wing to give the offensive passer signal, then the line of scrimmage guy will come up and tell him it didn't cross the line. Other than that, we go with it.
Here, quick question. Just say that pass is incomplete. You know, he overthrows it, underthrows it. Would you still want that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. The only time we wouldn't want it is if the quarterback just dumps it out of bounds.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, that's still a foul. Blocking downfield, right guard. There's another line of scrimmage, interior lineman. He's engaging the linebacker. He seeks him out more than a yard right there and is blocking. So again, this should be run or screen, and he decides to. What he does, and you can see really why. You know, he sees this player right here. This player, let's see if I can get a laser here. I can't get a laser anywhere. There we go. This player right here reads all this and comes up, safety comes up, and he dumps it over here. This even pisses offensive coaches off from what I've been told. This is what we want to stop. He can't do this. So this should be offensive pass interference.
Terry?
Yes.
Do you have someone blocking downfield, like a receiver blocking downfield, kind of clearing out for a screen?
Mm-hmm.
The screen gets snuffed out.
Mm-hmm.
And then they go to the other side of the field and throw it downfield. Would you call that
Yes.
FBI?
Yes. If an offensive player is blocking downfield, and there's a measure of time between that block and the ball thrown anywhere other than being dumped out of bounds, anywhere else, it has to be a foul. Even if the play really breaks down and it's going crazy and he throws it to the other side of the field, it has to be foul. It's an OPI hanging, and as soon as he throws it somewhere, you have to have it, because like I said, that the defense should be able to read runner screen from then on and play accordingly. Here we really shouldn't have had anything. It's an overthrown screen for one thing, and that is another part of this that we want to. If it's just an overthrown screen and happens to cross the line, it's still considered a screen. Ball not done cross the line. We don't want anything. So we shouldn't have an eligible downfield. We shouldn't have OPI right here. We shouldn't have anything. We wouldn't want OPI for timing anyway, even if this was. To another a legitimate receiver right here. Wouldn't want anything. There's just nothing here on this play. And here's two plays back to back that show you really how tough this is. Wide receiver at the top. Is this a foul or not? Is this a pick or not? Oh. I mean, I think it's a pick. You think it's a legal play? I can see. I'm not surprised. All right, the question is does this, first of all, it is more than a yard. So does he get to that spot first? In time for that defender to avoid contact. Oh, you finished the sentence. No. He seeks him out. He doesn't get there first. He doesn't give that defender time to adjust. So this is a foul. Doesn't get to that spot. Basically, he's still moving somewhat as he bumps him with his hip. This should have been offensive pass interference.
So you would consider him initiating that contact?
Absolutely. Absolutely. He's got to get there clearly first, look for the football, and then the guy running to him. He didn't get there in time on this play.
If he's running that route looking backwards and has that contact, you have nothing, right?
No. The onus is still on him to avoid contact. So if he's running a slant right here and they run into each other, that's still a foul because the onus is on him to avoid.
So you're kind of looking at this as like a block charge in basketball.
Somewhat, yeah. Yes. This play, now we watch the wide receiver at the top. Ball snapped at the 3. Where's the foul? Where's the block occur? The 2. This is not a foul. It certainly would be. Well, does he get there in time? I actually think that. Yeah. And then what did I say here? Yeah. I think he does get there in time. Stops, turns, and this guy takes 2 more steps really after he stopped. So this is a pretty good example. He actually got there first. Not a foul.
But, Kerry, yes. Didn't it look like man-to-man coverage there? And didn't that guy block the defender who was guarding him?
He did, but he got to the spot first, and he's looking for the ball. That's what they can do. They can get to a spot, stop, and now he's actually protecting himself, which he can do. But that's legal. If he can get to that spot first, then the defender has to go around. Which is just no foul. You got to clearly get to the spot first and give the defender time to change direction. Not RPS. All right, any questions on OPI? Probably a lot of questions, I know. All right, unsportsmanlike conduct. We all know there's the automatic fouls. There's taunting, which are automatic fouls, and then fouls that disrespect the game and opponent or officials. We go a little bit far. Let me go back to those. I think we do pretty good on the automatics, and we do pretty good on taunting. Here's where we kind of over-officiate sometimes. We start looking for things. We used to have a lot more automatics, the salute, the first down signal. But over the last few years, we've modified that somewhat to allow for spontaneous reactions that are not automatic and that are not taunting, as long as they're not prolonged. Certain things we will warn about. Here's an example. You know, he's doing the feed thing or whatever. He's not doing it to an opponent. He does it quickly, and then he's done. Just warn him on that one. Go warn him, go to the coach. Don't really like it, but it's just not prolonged enough. It's just not long enough for us to do an automatic since he's not doing it at somebody.
What's he cooking?
I don't even know what, I have no idea what that means. And again, taunting, here's an example where it's just not enough for a taunt. You're looking, you know, they end up right there. He looks over just for a second, and he starts backing out. Really not long enough for taunting. Make him stay there a little bit longer. The quick bow, just so you can see at the end of the end zone. Just the real quick one. Really, that's okay. That's like the salute. It's like the first down signal. It's very quick. It's not directed at any opponent. Just a quick bow is fine. Here's a similar one. Not even a warning. We're okay with that. That's pretty spontaneous and doesn't demean the game or anything like that. All right. If you look in the mechanics manual, there's guidance on when contact fouls become UNSs. After the play, and when they should either be, it's just a talk-to breakup, or it just stays UNR. And that guidance hasn't changed over the years, even though I think as you watch TV, you see a lot more tendency for a lot more unsportsmanlike conducts to send a message or whatever. I strongly disagree with that because the guidance is still the same. Anything during the continuing action, after the play's over, any contact is unnecessary roughness. It's not unsportsmanlike conduct. You don't ring him up for his first of two. It's just unnecessary roughness. Once they break up, once they should be going back to their huddle, and something happens, then it becomes UNS. So here's we'll get to that in a second. But here's something that you just can't miss. You watch these two guys at the bottom. So what do you have here? Anybody got a foul yet? Nobody has a foul for that. It's not targeting. He headbutts the guy right there. So this is unnecessary roughness. I mean, I consider this part of the continuing action. What about what 81 does right there? Let's say we didn't call a foul on 19. We didn't see that one. What about that right there? Is that enough for a foul? Yes? Who has a yes? That's not enough. That's just a little push. That's a breakup right there. Unfortunately, in this particular game, they called 81 for that push and didn't get anything on 19. And you have to look at this scenario. This is the wide receiver. And I'm sure if anybody's been around me long enough, you got one guy. You got one guy down here to watch. And you can't get this one right. You're going to penalize 81. I mean, maybe you miss 19. I don't know. Sometimes you blink or whatever and that happens. But you can't think that's enough from 81 for a foul. It's just never been enough. So you can't miss it that badly. We marked off 15 that way when we should have gone. That's a 30-yard difference. It's a 30-yard difference because whoever was down here just either lost focus or wasn't paying attention, didn't understand that a headbutt is a foul. And once he does that, you're going to want any retaliatory action by him to be really significant. A blow to the head, another headbutt, a big knockdown, something really out of the ordinary to offset this because this guy starts it right here, and that's the one you want to get. I don't know if it's forcible enough. Would you consider him a defenseless player? Yeah. You could make a case for that. I don't think it's forcible enough, personally. But in real time, you could make a case, and I would say we'll support it. We'd support it. I mean, he does lead with his head. It has all the aspects. Is 81 defenseless? I don't know. That might be he's not out of the play. I don't know. You have that long list. I don't know if he meets any of the categories of it. They're still kind of engaging each other. He's looking right at him. So I'd lean against targeting on this play and just go UNR. But you can make a case for it, certainly. All right. Hit at the sideline. You're looking at these two players engaged right here as the runner goes out of bounds. It's not UNS. They called UNS. It's not UNS. It's UNR. They're still engaged. I mean, the play is just barely over. It's certainly a foul, but you don't turn it into UNS. And one thing actually we kind of did modify a little bit in what we decided. If that altercation becomes extended, and we'll see it, I think it's on the replay here. Replay. If it becomes extended, you know, you got nothing, they're just jockeying. But now, at some point, they got to stop. This is just too long. Hit them both with UNS. I'm actually good with that. I have no problem with that at all. Because they can't. I think it took us too long to get there, by the way. I think this is You look how long it takes us to finally get in there. And where are we? Now we finally show up. Just took too long to recognize that. So I'm okay for an extended. Similar play here. I think you'll see it on this one on the replay as well. And of course, if whoever your supervisor is wants you to call UNS and do this, feel free to do that, because I'm not your supervisor or your coordinator. This is another extend. Here we go. Here. See, they start here, nothing. They're little pop there. They won't stop. So that's more of an extended altercation. I'm good with UNS there. All right. Any questions so far? Anyone want to take a break?
You'd be good with the part two on that last one?
Nah, somebody popped somebody in the head, didn't they?
Yeah.
How are we way back there? Hold on here. I think at some point, go fast forward again. I think somebody hit somebody in the head. Right there, yeah. So at that point, there has to become a foul right there. And I'm okay at that point. You know, if we just want to go U and R on the guy that hit him in the head, I'd be fine there too. But then he comes back, they keep going at each other, and then I'm good with the UNS. Do you want to take five?
Yeah.
Take, no? Yes?
I do.
Okay, go ahead. Take five. I'll figure out what I'm going to do next. I think we're going to go to targeting next, just straight up targeting. About another half an hour.
Guys, 8:10, let's start again, all right? 8:10.
Thank you.
I have to make a correction because, like I said, the blocking blow away is about as complicated as anything can get. So thanks. Who corrected me, Michael? Michael, thank you. Peelbacks. Anybody can do it until the ball leaves the tackle box, and then after that, nobody can do it. So what I said earlier, forget that. And Aaron's going to edit that out, right?
Sure.
Thank you, Aaron. All right, so I think we have about 30 minutes or so, and what better way to finish is with targeting, because it continues to be the most important thing we do. Player safety is crucial to our game. Our players have gotten a lot better. They're coached a lot better. They're not very, very few launches into the head. We still get a few. Still have a little ways to go, but our coaches are on board, and we're working on it. I won't go into replay calling this. I may mention it just as an aside, since a lot of you don't have replay. But this is a targeting foul, and it is one that we would want called by replay if it was not called on the field. Targeting. So, has an indicator. What's the indicator? He launches. Forcible contact to the head. It's a defenseless player. Meets all the criteria. This is a foul for targeting. It's a little closer. This is a dip and rip. This was called targeting, but it is still foul. He lowers his head, puts it into the chest, and then rips upward and makes forcible contact to the head and neck area. This is targeting and is a foul. Kind of a lot of mixed feelings on whether we want replay to call this. I think in the end we would. It's pretty obvious what he does. So this would also be a foul for targeting. And yes. So referees and potential center judges, just get a look at this. When he lowers that helmet, he's got a problem. And then he rips upward. I would want that. Yeah. I mean, he lowers it. You may have some crown involved, not quite, but it's getting close. And I know that our roughing the passer rules aren't real clear on leading with the helmet or whatever, but we really want at least roughing the passer when they lead with the helmet in the quarterback, whether it's targeting or not. Here we just really never get a good shot. Targeting was called. It's probably not. Defender's got his head up. He's trying to wrap. There may be some contact to the head. We just never get another shot. I think that's the best one we get on that one. This is close, but I don't think it's targeting. I think he's into the shoulder. Again, we don't get a good look at it. Looks like he hits helmet to shoulder right there. Probably not targeting. Defenseless player. This is not targeting. We had a lot of discussions about this play. It is a late hit. So we'd want you to call, if on the field real time, you're probably going to call targeting. But we'd want you to call late hit with targeting because we want to penalize this. Play's clearly over. But he does try and avoid, and he makes glancing contact to the head with maybe the back of the shoulder or something. So really not targeting. There's not an indicator there. And just glancing contact to the head. But it is unnecessary roughness at a minimum. It's a late hit on a receiver. Here's a player on the ground after an interception, correctly called targeting. leads with his head, helmet to helmet. No. He looks like he's sliding. Well, you do have a feet first there, don't you? Of course, it is a late slide. We would consider that a feet first slide. It's the first time I looked at it like that. But yeah, appears to be a feet first slide right there. And forcible contact. They called a well, he's on the ground anyway when contact occurred, but even if it was earlier, yeah, we'd still want it. Good point.
Gary?
Yes?
We're going to talk about sliding that kind of slid into the player. Did you say that was imminent?
Let's go. Yeah, but you're still protected from targeting. He's dead neck area, so he wouldn't be protected from unnecessary roughness. Let's look at the line feed. So it is a late slide. I'm not even sure I'd call this a slide looking at it at this angle. He's going to the side. So, no, I wouldn't do that looking at this angle. See his body going to the side. Feet first really means sliding your feet forward. And it is contact was imminent. So what makes this targeting a defenseless player is he's already on the ground when contact occurs. Targeting. We'd want replay to come down on this one. Upward thrust. Targets the head and neck area. Leads with the helmet. All the indicators are there. How he kept on. Held the football, I'll never know. Replay would not come down. This isn't not a, we wouldn't consider this egregious. I think we get a shoulder of the helmet.
That wasn't called, did you?
No, we would not want replay coming down on this one. Because it's somewhat glancing right there. I think replay would let it stand this year. Anytime a replay would just let it stand, then. Leads with his shoulder. I mean, that's the closest I'd come with it. I think there is forcible contact to the head with the shoulder. And he looks like he leads with it coming in to make contact to the head. But I don't know if it's forcible enough. So if we call it on the field, I'd let that stand. I don't think there's indisputable evidence that it wasn't. There wasn't an indicator there.
If it wasn't called, would you have been okay with it?
Yeah. Yeah, this is right in between. But I think in real time, it's going to be called most of the time. On that one. That wouldn't be a tough one to avoid. Unnecessary roughness with targeting. He's got the launch here. There's two fouls. Well, I think there was a DH on it, and then the targeting comes in later. I think the targeting, Todd calls the targeting from the bottom of the screen, I think. Player on the ground. Not even sure what he's thinking. Yeah, that would be the old spearing rule, which we don't have anymore, but certainly a targeting. He's on the ground, he leads with his helmet into the head of the opponent, so targeting. This one really doesn't have an indicator. Or at least is it an upward thrust or is it not? Probably would be a stands in replay. I mean, certainly forcible contact to the head and neck area with the shoulder, but whether there's a strong indicator there, I don't think so. Although I don't think I'd want it reversed. Tough play. Kind of more of that dip and rip. We didn't call targeting on this one. I think we called a late hit, which it probably isn't. You know, talking to some of our replay guys, I think if he drops this ball, it's an incomplete pass because I don't think he's got it long enough. So probably not a late hit, close to targeting. Probably best nothing on that play. Watch, where's the motion? Watch the guy running at the 25-yard line. Watch this guy right here. This is targeting. Player out of the play. Launches upward into his head. We didn't get this one. So whose man is it? Belongs to the back judge. Back judge, maybe over here as well. They may have had a switch at some point. He wasn't happy about it, to say the least. Interestingly, the most bizarre part of this story, this exact player, I put this on the training tape, this exact player the very next week had a different opponent do the exact same thing to him. Exact same play, and we actually called that one, so that was a good thing. Let's go to blindside hits. End zone. This one was really, our center judge picks this one up. Blindside hit. Lowers his helmet to helmet contact right there. Leads with his helmet into a defenseless player. Blindside. Pretty good call on a kickoff.
Where's the action on the ball? I mean, you don't think he's in a position to
defend himself? No. He's coming from, if I'm coming this way and he's coming this way.
He's looking at the ball carrier.
Right. 10 at the last second realizes he's about to get clobbered. He can't protect himself. So that's absolutely a defense. It's absolutely blindside. I think this is the big picture of it. You got to be alert on kickoffs for guys, and I believe here he comes right here. So if you're watching the teams you're going to work, you have that opportunity and you watch their kickoffs and you see them coming across like this as part of their return scheme, that would be something that would jump out at you. One of the best calls of the year. So it's a free ball. I mean, anybody can get it. But this is a blindside hit. He's defenseless. Can't protect himself. There he is. Oof. That's about as defenseless as it gets. Another blindside hit.
Terry, that one would be penalized from the previous spot?
It would. Good point. Yes, it would. During the kick. Or was that the kicking team that did that or the receiving team? Receiving team? Okay. Because the kicking team, then you could tack it on if the receiving team ended up with the football. Another blindside hit. A lot of good looks at that one. He's with his helmet. Some coaches are getting really smart. They're starting to tell their players, if you find yourself, don't hit them at all. Because nothing good. It's going to be a block in the back. It's going to be low block. It's going to be targeting. Nothing good happens unless you do it exactly right. So a lot of coaches are coaching, don't even hit him. Another blindside hit. Looking up here, this one's close. We never get a really good look at as to whether he hits him in the head or not. But you have to think about this play. When you see somebody, you're up here, or maybe as a center judge, you see this guy coming back this way, that your radar has to go up, and you have to know what happens. Saw that one. Wide receiver at the top. Side judges, field judges. When your guy cuts back this way, he's got a block but above the knee and below the neck, shoulders are below. In the end zone, this is really close. Would support it, certainly. Looks like he gets him in the head right there. Certainly forcible. Not blindside. In here, shoulder to shoulder, really no contact to the neck area. Understand why it's called in real time. This is really hard to avoid, but replay correctly reverse that one. Good shoulder to shoulder hit. Crown, a couple of these. He's not down yet, by the way. He did not go down. So the ball's still in play. All right, number 7. We get a really good look. Joe. Did you call this one, Joe? This was good. Nobody thinks it's a foul until we get this shot. And then everybody thinks it's a foul. Is it you and your crew? Before that, your crew wasn't happy with that before that, huh? Replay, the Pac-12 confirmed that?
Yeah.
As well as should, yeah. Good call. Another crown. We got a better look on the end zone. crowns are really tough to get. Close to crown, it's right in there. We saw that player earlier. I think he fixed it after this one. It's in the note. Roughing the passer, but not targeting. Oh, no, excuse me. I went too far. Go back to this one. Roughing the passer, but not targeting. Shoulder to chest. Maybe glancing contact to the head, but it's late. So we call roughing the passer with targeting. I think they reverse targeting and replay. And a big hit at the end of the game. That is not targeting. Understood why it was thrown. Really just glancing contact right there. Actually, I take that back. And this is one of our problems. We had a little bit of problem with replay. Replay on this one let it stand. So the player was disqualified. And then the same replay, you got to be consistent. Same replay official, put this player back in. They should have put both of them back in, but you can't do one without the other. Is this player defenseless or a runner? In real time, is he defenseless or a runner? It's really close. I think he is a runner. I think if we, let me go back. If he drops the football when he, on contact. Yeah, I would tend to make him a runner, but it's really close. I think if on the field we wave this off as incomplete, we wouldn't want replay reverse. It's not enough to reverse. In real time, if this is a helmet-to-helmet shot, you're probably going to throw. It's that close. And here, really great no call. You can almost see it from here, shoulder to shoulder. There's certainly no there's no indicator right there at all. He's lowered his target. There may be glancing contact. See, fourth and sixth play, pretty big play. Actually, maybe not even glancing contact. Not everybody agreed at the time. Just not everybody agreed at the time. In fact, some people strongly disagreed. Might handle that a little differently, but okay. I think he did end up getting penalized on that play. Here's probably your best shot. Not a foul. Really, really good. And that's what we want our defenders to do. That's as good as it can get. Here are a bunch of no fouls, shoulder to shoulder. This is how good players are getting. Heads out in front. Just go shoulder, force the contact shoulder to shoulder. Legal punishing hit. Remember, a blindside hit, you cannot have a foul for a blindside hit unless it's targeting. You can't have a UNR on this. You cannot throw a flag and just call UNR with targeting or UNR without targeting or anything. And this is a perfectly legal block. He's chasing the runner. He's not out of the play. It's not targeting, so this is just not a foul. Incorrectly reversed on this one. Really no contact to the head and neck area. Sometimes we don't get them right, that's why we have replay. And the last one, legal punishing hit, no foul. That's what we want them to do. All right, questions on targeting. Question, really anything. We can kind of finish up with a question and answer, anything on the new rules, new guidelines, new philosophies that I can help you with. Everybody ready to go? I hope so. Joe, you ready to go? You got it? You got it all down? Oh, intentional grounding. I'll tell you, a question came up, intentional grounding at one of camps. I haven't seen the video. Referees in here? Referees. And more important, other officials that call the intentional grounding in here, obviously. Player in the red zone. Quarterback goes back to pass. Can't find anybody. He's under pressure, and he throws it out of the end zone. What's our guidelines on that? He's in the tackle box. Or he's in the pot. Yeah, he's in the tackle box. What's our guidelines on that? He's under duress.
Conserving time or conserving yardage.
No, catchable's not in there. Is there a receiver in the area? Our guidelines are, it's direction and vicinity. But if he's throwing it out of the end zone, how high can he throw it? How high can he throw it? The guidance is if there's a receiver and he throws it over his head halfway in the end zone or deeper, and he throws it over his head, it's nothing. I mean, no, he can't launch it into the upper deck, but he's not going to do that. He can throw it into the bleachers if he wants to. But if it goes over a receiver's head who's in the back half of the end zone, let it go. It's just like the sideline. It's just like the sideline with a player outside the numbers. He throws it over his head. We don't care how high he throws it. Just throw it over his head. There's, I think it might still be on the CFI website, some really good guidelines that I don't know who wrote them a while back on intentional grounding, but you might want to review those. But that's our guidance. If he's in the front half of the end zone, he's not in the vicinity. We're not going to put him there. It's just like if he's inside the numbers, can't just throw it out of bounds way over his head. Anything else? On scrimmage, guys, any questions? No? All right. Good luck, guys.